So welcome. It's good to did you survive the polar vortex? What a name for it. We used to just call it cold, right? Now it's polar vortex. What an awesome week. Anybody have their frozen pipes? Anybody? You guys had frozen pipes? Sorry, guys. I'm glad it thawed out eventually. Good. You're good now. Good. That's good. Yeah, you smell better, so that's good. The showers are working. That's my nephew. I can say that to him down there. If you're thriving, one of the areas you need to thrive is your finances. And I just want to make this public appeal. Sometimes just having the conversation is the start. I know a lot of couples that are just struggling. They make enough money to live on, but it just seems like they never have enough at the end of the month. And we struggle over what's our priorities and our values. And what I love about financial peace, it gets you together to talk about it. And you can actually have a conversation in a very civil way and then come up with a plan. And we've experienced tremendous freedom, the families that have been through this. So if you'd like to do that, you should register soon. We do have child care. It's on the same night as Reengage. What you need to do is register either today or tomorrow, because we're going to be closing it soon. So if you could do that, it's actually going to be held. Let's see, I got to turn this on. Going to be held on Sunday evenings at 6:30. Love to have you come for the next 9 weeks. We've been going through a series called Upstream, Navigating a Rapidly Changing Culture. The world around us is changing quickly. And what I've discovered is it's often opposing us. That's why we use the term upstream. It feels like more and more I'm having to travel against the flow. The currents of time are washing against me. And we need to swim upstream. Last week, Pastor Bob began with a great, great insight on our perspective. It's so important to know who we are and where we are. To know who we are in Christ. And he did a marvelous job of looking at 1 Peter, which was actually a challenging place. People at that time were traveling upstream and discovered that our identity in Christ is that we are wanted, valued, loved, and secure. And if we know our identity, it changes everything. The world can say what it wants about us, but we know who we are. And that's a lot of our struggle today. As we're going upstream, we don't know what we believe, we don't know who we are, and we're carried away and get frustrated. What Bob said many times last week was, your behavior flows from your identity. What you do flows naturally from who you are. And if you know who you are in Christ, it affects the way you relate to other people. I saw a video. Somebody sent me a copy from the quarterback from Clemson that beat Auburn. That beat Alabama 44-16. Did you remember that? Any Alabama fans here? You're still kind of struggling with that. And it was a young quarterback, 19 years old. I mean, he was playing amazing. Tom Brady, his actual manager or his agent, is trying to get him to sign on at 19 years old. And they asked him earlier this year, when you're taking this position, how does it affect you? I mean, what happens if you play badly? What happens if people call you out? This is what he said. I thought it was so
good. That's just kind of always been my personality. And then just growing up, my family's always like, I mean, football's important to me, obviously, but it's not my life. It's not like the biggest thing in my life, I would say. My faith is. So that just comes from kind of knowing who I am outside of that. So I just know no matter how big the situation is, it's not really going to define me. Just putting my identity in, you know, what Christ says, who he thinks I am and who I know that he says I am. So really, like I said, at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter what people think about me or how good they think I play or whatever, you know, it doesn't really matter. So that's definitely been a big thing for me, just in my situation, just knowing that and having confidence in that.
Isn't that amazing? This young man recognizes that who I am is the most important thing. He's got linebackers chasing him. He's got press trying to catch him and trip him up. He's got coaches and other players hassling him. In all that, he says, it doesn't matter. In fact, the football that I hold very gently because this is not my life. My life is in Jesus Christ. And my identity determines how I behave. Now, I think that's just so important. So for many of you today, I just need to ask, who are you? That will determine, as you're going upstream, how strong you are. I want to ask this question. So what should be my response then? If I'm swimming upstream, how do I respond to all these people around me? What does God expect of me? How should we treat other people? I brought my friend here, Sometimes it concerns me. People give me things, and I wonder, why did they give me this? And they gave me this little guy here. Pretty cute, huh? Kind of looks a little bit like, I think that looks like Craig, doesn't it? You know, well, anyway, really, really handsome guy, okay? But he's got a special gift. Let me show you a special gift. Oh.
I couldn't agree with you more completely.
Oh, he's awesome, isn't he?
Oh, yeah, I'm behind you all the way. I'm sure whatever you're thinking is correct.
Oh. I want to marry him. Like.
Hey, I wish I'd thought of that.
He's just awesome. He's called the Yes Man.
What can I say? When you're right, you're right.
Oh, yes. God, tell it. Preach it, brother. Everybody wants a Yes Man. We all want people to agree with us, to say that we're brilliant, to say that was the smartest thing you've ever heard. You're the right man. I'm going to follow you. We like Yes Men. But you know what I've discovered in life? It's full of no way men. My life is filled with people say, no way, I ain't going to do that. No way, that's baloney. No way, I don't think that's right. No way. And so to be honest, if it was about yes men, this would be easy. And to be honest, Jesus said, you're going to experience trouble in the world. All kinds of people blocking your path. This picture of the fish swimming upstream is what your life is going to look like. So how do you treat those other fish that are crashing into you, colliding into you? How should we treat difficult people? I think that's an important question. And some of you live in difficult situations. I'm going to pray at the end of the service just asking that God would identify two or three difficult people in your life. And you probably know who that is and how you're going to respond to them differently based upon our discussion today. So how should we respond? Well, I'm going to go to a great expert, Dory, the fish, okay? Just keep on swimming, and loving people. Now, I just really think this is true. We can't give up. We can't give in. We can't stop. We have to keep swimming, even if it's upstream. Even if it's hard, even if it's difficult, even if people are coming at us, we have to keep on keeping on. That's what the Bible tells us. But doing that by loving people. Now, this would be a simple sermon. I could just stand right there. But a lot of you would go home and say, yeah, I love people. Yeah, I love people. I just don't like them. And you can't say that. Do you really love people? People that are against you in every way. People that have lifestyles that are completely different than you. People that shout out at you, people that carry placards that call you down. Do you love them? Now, this just isn't Dory. It's Jesus talking. Jesus said this. First of all, you got to love God. You got to be in this vertical relationship with God. You got to know God who created you, who loves you, has a plan and a purpose for you. You got to grow in that relationship with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, all that you are. And then secondly, you got to love your neighbor. Now, your neighbor is that fish going the other direction. Your neighbor is that fish that's hard in your life. A neighbor might be your spouse who sees things differently than you. It might be that person that you're constantly in disagreements with. It's that neighbor that you've been called to love, to move upstream even with them. It's interesting when I think about what Jesus said. He said, you have to love, yes, your brother, your sister, your mom, your dad, and your enemy. You see, even the person who's out to destroy you, that denies you, that wants to defeat you completely, that person you've been called to love. Now, when I say that, what does it mean to love this person? It can be so challenging. Now, there's a wonderful resource out there. You know Bob Goff? You ever hear Bob Goff? Christian writer that's on the preaching circuit. We wanted him to come to Thrive, but I think he would cost more than the building, so we couldn't bring him. But he's just a great, great man who just speaks of what love is. In his first book called Love Does, it's not something you just talk about, it's something you do. And I would just encourage you to pick this book up and read it. You can find it cheap at a lot of the different places. And I just found it really helpful. It's one of the few books. Usually I read through books and I tear out pages. That's what I do. Because most books is about 10 pages are worth keeping. And so that's what I do. And I went through his book and I realized I need to go buy another book. I tore out so many pages that I just might as well keep the book. It's that good. And then he's got a second book. I bought all the shepherds, and this is their Christmas gift. Love is loving everybody always. And you might not be able to read the little small print, but it says this, becoming love, a world full of setbacks and difficult people. Can you learn to love those no way people? And he talks about how we can do that. He says something that's just been so guiding in my life. When you come to a situation where you don't know how to respond, this is what you do. You do the most loving thing for them. The most loving thing. So somebody asks you, would you do this? Or they ask you what you think about this. You respond in the most loving way possible. But how do we know what that is? So that's what I want to guide us with today. Really quickly, from 2 Timothy chapter 2. Paul writes to his spiritual son, Timothy. This is a series of letters that he writes in the Bible shortly after the death and resurrection of Jesus. And Paul corresponds with his spiritual son. And he says, I want you to succeed in the world. We live in an upstream world, in a troubled world, and these are difficult times. And I want you to know what to do, how to respond. And so he writes in 2 Timothy chapter 2, very specifically to us today. And I'm going to look at it in two different ways. First of all, how not to treat difficult people. So if you're doing notes for confirmation, two different things. First, how not to treat people, very simply. And then how to treat people. What is a loving response? I'm going to ask you to stand because I've been sitting too long. I want you to read scripture with me. And hopefully you might see yourself and some words might jump out at you here. So let's just read 2 Timothy, the first two verses, 22 and 23, okay? Flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Don't have anything to do with a foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels. Father God, we built some very, very callousness around ourselves to protect ourselves in this world. Today I ask that you might make us vulnerable, that your Holy Spirit might speak and show us what the most loving thing is to do. In Jesus' name, amen. I think you may be seated. When I was younger, I would read this text, and it would jump out at me, flee the evil desires of youth, and I would always put in the word lust. Something about being 16-year-old with hormones, right? And I think that's what the youth counselors were telling us. You know, you got to deal, flee those evil desires of youth. I'm looking as I grow older, no, it's the temptation to argue with people. Lust is too much work. Arguing is fun. And as I look at this, there's something about when we're young, 2 or 3 years old. You ever notice how your little two-year-old can argue with you? Did you have to train them how to do that? You're being way too cooperative. You have to stop agreeing with daddy. You have to be disagreeable. It's not the way it works. Our kids grow up at a young age to know how to be oppositional. And so do we. And I've just discovered that the temptation then, as we've learned as a young person, is then to take on people in arguments. And the words that jump out at me in this text, the most unloving thing you can do with people is argue with them. And it leads to quarrels. When I looked at this text, I thought, what's the difference between a quarrel and an argument? You know what a quarrel is? It's just an angry argument. It's one where the temperature's increased. And to be honest, I think it's the go-to for a lot of us. When we hear a story on the news, when we hear some things from other people, when we see the lifestyle of a friend of ours that we're concerned about, the first thing we want to do is go argue with them. We want them to see the truth. We want to know where their behavior leads and their logic is misled, and we want to come in and set them straight. And I confess, that's what I want to do. I'm good at arguing. I can quarrel with people. So sometimes I find myself arguing over things that just don't matter. And that's what this text is saying. No. If you want to do what God says in this world, you need to pursue righteousness and faith and love and peace with a pure heart. Now, when I talk about this, I really believe that some of you win arguments and you lose influence. You know what I'm saying? We live in this world that wants to see the truth. And yet we approach them with arguing spirits. We might disagree, but we become disagreeable. And we might win that argument. We lose a relationship. We win that argument. We lose the opportunity to see an influence in their life. Without contact, there's no impact. And for a lot of us, our arguing has pushed people away, the very people that God has called us to influence. So we need to stop arguing. What does it say? Don't have anything to do with it. Run away from it. You enter in an argument, stop! It doesn't accomplish anything. Now, when I say that, I just need to say that we need to speak up. We need to tell truth. This thing in New York with abortion through 9 months, full term, makes no sense, right? I look at that and I just say, I can't sit back and be silent. Somebody has to speak for this little baby that has no voice. And I think we as Christians need to speak up. We need to be honest about truth. Silence becomes dogma in the world. Silence becomes permission. But not argue. Stop arguing. But we can speak. We can set boundaries with people. Good boundaries that honor relationships and say, no, that kind of language, I don't need that language here. I think that's okay. But to argue with people. And I think you know what I'm saying. And for many of us, the go-to place is to argue. I remember my daughter. She's about 16, and she was making some decisions, choices I didn't like, and I pulled her aside, and I said, honey, why don't you talk to me about this? She said something that I'll never forget. She said, Dad, when I talk to you, you argue with me, and I feel so powerless. You see, I didn't realize that as her dad and in our relationship, I would come in with this power, and what I said had to be. At 16, you just push up against that. And I just discovered if you have teenagers, arguing with them it isn't going to accomplish anything anymore. So love them. So what does it look like to love? And that's what I'm going to look at. Because to be honest, our response to difficult people has to be loving. I think Tim Everson from our church had this on his Facebook, and I just clipped it because I thought it was so good. We do not draw people to Christ by loudly discrediting what they believe. Boy, I do that. By telling them how wrong they are and how right we are. You ever do that in your mind? Some of you might not be verbal like me, but you read the paper and say, oh, boy, I would tell them this, and I would, you know, we always win those arguments, don't we? And we're always arguing with people in our heads. It doesn't work, but by showing them a light, that's what we must do. That is so lovely, so they want with all their hearts to know the source of it. We're to be salt, yes, but also light, shining in people's way. So what does that look like? It goes on in 2 Timothy, and I've chose to read from the New King James Version because I think it just says it so well. And it gives us five things just in this verse 24 that we can do that are loving when we're swimming upstream. And if you find yourself in situations where people are opposing you, people are doing things that bother you, and you'd like to see some influence in their life, here is a way to do it by loving them. So first of all, we are to be servants of the Lord. We must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient in humility, correcting those who are in opposition. I've taken those five different phrases and made them into questions. Because I think it's easy for us to say, yeah, I love people. Well, do you? Ask this question, these series of questions. First of all, what I'm doing, am I serving them? Am I serving difficult people? I've just discovered that when you're on bended knee helping somebody, it's really difficult to argue with them. And if we serve people, it's amazing how we can learn what their life is like, what their behavior is like. One of the reasons I love loaves and fishes is it brings some people in that might not be in my social circle. And I spend time talking to them, and I learn to love them as they are, as I serve them. Where might that be for you? It's interesting to me, when you serve them, it's a part of loving them. And to serve them is not out of pity. It's not to serve them, to influence them, to change them. No, you serve them because you respect them. And this is the huge challenge I'm giving you today. Am I serving this person? Am I meeting their needs? Am I coming alongside and caring for them? Because they don't care what I have to say until they know that I care. We understand that. And as we serve them, there's something that happens that's magical over time where they might want to listen. But what it says, live as servants of God, Peter says. Show proper respect to everyone. Everyone. Not those that deserve it. You see, this is what happens. So many of us as Christians say, oh, I will respect the people that deserve it. No. That's not what the Bible says. You respect every person. Every person. Not because they deserve it, but because they were designed for it. They're created in the very design of God. They're in the image of God. And when I come alongside and I serve someone, it's because I see in that person the very image of the Father. And it matters not what they've done. It matters not where they've been. I serve them because they represent God to me. And that's biblical. And what's fascinating to me is I was going to take a penny and put it here, and I was going to take a $100 bill, but I didn't have one floating around, okay? And I was going to crumple up the $100 bill and get all dirty and stomp on it and take the penny and do that and say the penny you might think twice about getting. But you understand the $100 bill still has value. And if I said, would you like it? Oh, yeah, I'll come get that. I'll take a dirty old white ping pong ball. I'll take that because it still has value. And what I've discovered in my life, every person has value to God. Every person. And God has called me to serve them. Now, it's interesting what he says. A simple mantra for us, love the brotherhood of believers. In other words, you've got to respect people here in church, the believers. Fear God, have this right relationship with God, and then this, honor the king. You know, those in government, our president, to honor and respect him. Has that been your language lately? To take the representatives. I've gone to some town hall meetings, and the way that people speak to one another, it's so unkind. Might that not be us? To come alongside and speak truth and love and care. I'm going to tell this story. When I, my first church I was at, my daughter brought home a book from the library, public library, and it had a bad story. It was just a bad book. It taught bad things, and it was a bad book. And one of my other friends, a pastor, they'd risen up against the library because they had so many bad books, so they actually marched into the school board meeting, sat in the front row, and they had this battle, and then free speech, and then they said, no, we got to keep the book in the library, and I said, no way. So they left all frustrated, and the church was seen as bad, and I said, what am I going to do? This book should not be here. So I called up the principal. I knew it was his 50th birthday happening, and I said, can I take you out for lunch? He said, oh, that'd be great. I knew him, Mr. Rose, and had three kids in the school, and took him out for his birthday, and we celebrated. I heard about his story and what was going on, and finally, towards the end of the meeting, I just took the book out. I said, John, this book is really bad. What it teaches is just goofy. We shouldn't have this book in our library here at this town. And he looked at that book. He said, you're right. He said, we'll not put this on the shelf. You see, you can accomplish different things by respecting people, by not immediately confronting them and entering into an argument. You know, some of us, I think this is so true, some of us are correct, but we're not right. You know what I'm saying? We don't respond to people out of respect. We respond out of our judgment. We have good judgment, but we walk in judgment. And we need to learn how somehow to come alongside people with respect by serving them. It goes on and says, slaves, to submit or serve your masters with all respect. These are masters, not only the good ones, but the bad ones. Now, either Peter is not telling us the truth, or you and I have some growth to do. We are to serve people who even mistreat us. Boy, that can be a challenge. Am I being gentle with them? So to be loving with difficult people is to truly serve them, to come alongside them, to meet their needs. And then secondly, it's to be gentle with them. Now, I've discovered that sometimes being gentle means to know what's going on in a person's life. You can't be gentle if you don't know them. I had a good friend here one day, and he was at the back, and I went up and I shook his hand really hard like I do, because a preacher's got to shake a hand strong, not some wimpy thing my dad taught me, right? So I grabbed his hand, I shook it, and he went, oh, and he's a strong, he's a weightlifter, he's a strong guy. And I said, what's wrong? He said, well, I fell off a ladder and broke my arm this week. I'm shaking his arm. Why don't you have a cast on? He's too tough to wear a cast, right? But I realize that I need to be gentle because I don't know what's going on in his life. So I disagree with people, and there are people that are opposed to me. Do I know their story? Do I know what's been going on in their life? And sometimes by coming up to them and with my aggressive spirit, and I shake them, and I'm not being gentle. Now, you might see some of the people that yell the loudest, that are opposing you the most. Those are the people that need the most gentleness in your life. Can you come alongside them and care for them? Can you do that? I remember Covey had a book, if you remember, beginning with the end in mind, if you remember the whole story about how we can improve our leadership and skills. And he has a chapter in there about appearances that I've never forgotten. But a man, how he's riding in a subway one day, and there was a man in there with his two sons, and the two sons were just being crazy and were jumping around, and they were running around the subway. They were terrorizing everybody in the subway. And Covey was about to go over and confront the man and say, get your kids in line, would you? You ever get at that place? Can't you control your kids? These kids are out of line. And all of a sudden, he stopped and he listened to the man, and he heard him tell his sons, I know Mom passed away today. Everything's going to be okay. He found out earlier that day that their mom had been in the hospital and she had died. And these kids were acting out. What they needed was not a rebuke, but a gentle spirit to come alongside them. And that's a lot of the people we face. I love what Peter says again in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, and Bob kind of left this for me. He said, set apart Christ as Lord, verse 15, set apart in your heart, and then always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect. Always be ready to talk about what you believe. Yeah, it's okay to be ready to share when people ask. Wait till they ask. That's gentleness. To not offer an unsolicited opinion, not to pound them with things of truth, but to wait until they ask. And when they ask, be ready to give them the hope that's within, but gentleness. Be guarding their spirit. It also says, am I able to teach them? Be ready to give a reason for the hope that's within you, the hope that's in the scriptures. You know, we are people of the book, and yet a lot of us don't know what the Bible teaches. And to be honest, too often we look at the Bible as an opportunity to use it as a weapon on people. I'm going to use that Bible, I'm going to change them, I'm going to hit them over the head with that, and we use it as this sledgehammer, and that's not how it was intended. The Bible is God's love letter to the world, and in that he gives direction. It's medicine for the brokenhearted. It's encouragement for the downhearted. It comes alongside people. The word of God is powerful in people's lives. But you and I need to know it. Be ready to teach it. Because I believe if you come alongside and you serve people with gentleness, eventually they're going to say, so what do you believe? You're different. It's interesting. The Bible says that we should not be the stumbling blocks. The cross is the stumbling block. People who stumble over the idea of grace, that's what people should be stumbling over. But usually they stumble over Christians who either don't know the Bible or aren't being gentle. And I really believe that if you and I just recognize the opposition swimming against us, and we began to love and serve them with great gentleness, they will start asking us, why are you so different? Why do you do that with your children? How come you live your life like this? And then be ready to show them in the Bible why you believe what you believe. It's interesting. Just a few verses before, in verse 15, it's a verse that a lot of you know. It's a verse for Awana. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who does not need to be ashamed, who correctly handles the word of truth. If you're loving, you're going to look at the scriptures as a marvelous opportunity to know what you believe so that when people ask, you can share it with them. Another question you should ask, am I being patient with them? I'm so impatient. I'm a microwave kind of guy. No slow cookers for me, man. I mean, I put things in, anything, and I could cook it quick. And that's what I want to see in people's life. I want to see transformation overnight. I want to see people going as new creations today. And I have people that come in and they have arguments, and I want to see them make the decision. And I've been to evangelism school where you ask and you push and you say, you got to decide today. If you were to die tonight, in the next 2 minutes. And I'm realizing God is calling me to be patient. Like a farmer. James chapter 5, be patient until the Lord's coming. He could show up in this person's life at any moment, but be patient. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, how patient he is. Be patient, stand firm, because God is coming. He's near. I was taught this a long time ago, that in people's lives, they really know about God. In Romans chapter 1, they know the truth about God, even his invisible qualities. They know who God is, but there's things that have happened in their life that prevent them from coming to God. And these obstacles, it might be something their father said. It might be the way they were treated by the church. It might be something they learned in college. It might be a partner at a job. It might be a tragic event in their life, the loss of a loved one. All these things are barriers in their life. And I've discovered that God has placed me in their life to maybe just help them take the next step. I want them to go like this. I want them to become converted. I want to have flowers. And God says, no, what you need to do in this upstream community is just move people one step closer. Just one step. Loving them, serving them, being gentle with them, opening the word of God, sharing when you can, and just one step until they're home. George Mueller, great man of God, prayed for 5 of his friends that they would come to know Christ. He had more faith than I'll ever have. He was just an amazing man. And he prayed and prayed and prayed, and it took forever for his one friend to come to know Christ. And then about 20 years in, another friend came to know Christ. And then about 30 years, and on his deathbed, he had one friend that hadn't accepted Christ. And on his deathbed, George Mueller was told, your friend just accepted Jesus. Patience. Can you be patient with people? That's loving in an upstream world. Then last of all, am I being humble? in humility. We then present the truth to those, correcting in humility. To be honest, Pastor Bob wanted me to spend most of my time talking about humility, and I'm out of time. But I just need to say this, that humility is just so important in anything we do. It's not about you. Now, it doesn't mean having low self-esteem. It doesn't mean deprecating who you are. You are creating God's image. Know your identity, that you're a child of God. You're a son of the king. Know who you are. And then out of that, you can be truly humble. You can listen to other people who disagree with you, and it doesn't offend you. You can find yourself failing in the world's standards, eyes, but you're okay because in that humility, you've learned who you are. My favorite text on this is out of Philippians chapter 2, and it compares us with Jesus. He who is equal with God did not consider equality with God something to be held, grasped, but he emptied himself and he became a servant, serving us on the cross. Now, that's Jesus. He's our example. And then it goes on, and it says this, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. That's why I argue. It's because of my pride. It's because of my ambition. It's because of my conceit. I need to stop quarreling, somehow trying to build myself up. No. In humility, consider others better than yourself. I just want to consider others. Do you even think of other people? Sometimes when you're talking and you're on your soapbox and you're preaching, are you thinking about the people who are listening? Every once in a while, I'm at a coffee shop and I'm talking to somebody about a deep spiritual truth, and I stop and I think, no, what are these other people hearing? What are they listening to? In humility, can I consider them as I'm talking? Do you consider your spouse as better than yourself? Do you consider her as you look to her interests, his interests, not just your own? When you think of the other people in your life that are opposing you, can you be truly humble? There's one more verse and one more question. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance. You see, when it comes to the opposition, I want to see them change direction. They're heading towards destruction, the Bible says. There's this one path, and many are going the wrong way, and it leads to destruction. I care about them, and I don't want to see their lives broken, but I can't change them. It says, in the hope that God will grant them. You see, God can turn them around, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. You see, what I see so clearly, other people can't see. The God of this age has blinded them, and in all my logic, all my arguments, they do no good. God has called me to be a witness, not a lawyer. And when I try and argue people into the kingdom, this is the danger. It just hit me. If I can argue somebody into the kingdom, somebody can argue them out of the kingdom. Do you get that? But if God puts them in the kingdom, nobody can take them away. And so I want to be patient, just trusting that God is able. So you have a son who's struggling right now, and you just see this brain-dead young man, and you say, how can he be making these decisions? He's been trapped. And you can't set him free, but only God can. And in prayer, in service, and in humility, and gentleness, and love, you come alongside him and you care about him, being patient that when God shows up, you'll see a life changed. And I'm confident of that. So have you identified the two or three people that right now are kind of obstinate in your life? They're oppositional, that are going the wrong way, and you'd love to do anything to change their direction? Identify them, and then ask yourself, am I serving them? Am I being gentle with them? Am I able to teach them? If they ask me for the hope, would I be able to tell them where my hope comes from? Am I being patient with them, waiting for God to do his work? Am I being humble, or is it about me? As a parent, is it about me? A spouse, is it about me, or is it about them? And then last of all, am I confident that God will begin a good work in them, and he'll carry it to completion. Let's pray. Father God, I want so much to teach truth, but you want me to do truth and love together. God, those two have to be side by side. Truth and grace, truth and grace, truth and love, truth and love. And God, I recognize in this world that opposes us, there are many, many difficult people that we face. God, I pray that you might show us how we might walk in that balance of truth and love. Today. And I pray like Dory. that we might learn to swim, keep swimming, and loving people in the name of Jesus. Thank you. In your name we pray.